Good afternoon, everyone. Thank you all for coming. I have a number of my colleagues here, some of our students from Ryerson, former colleagues, and a number of people that I came to know after coming here. So thank you all for coming, especially taking time to come and listen to me. I will try and make it in 40 minutes. I might skip a whole lot of areas around theories of integration and theories of immigration and stuff like that. They are very relevant, but not necessarily in this particular case, simply because we just don't have the time. I'll start my presentation by saying that globalization has actually enhanced the speed of immigration. When we talk about migration in current era, we talk about the fact that didn't we have migration all along? It is true, but it is globalization that actually increased or accelerated the pace of mass migration, especially from developing countries to developed countries. You could argue that globalization or migration results in social change, and whereas you could also argue that social change results in migration. Now, without going into the details of all the theories about globalization and how migration and why migration happens, I'm just going to talk about an article that was written by Stephen Cassels, one of my favorite authors, who looks at globalization and migration from a very macro perspective. And he actually analyzes the trends that happen in migration. So that's the outline of my presentation, but that's okay. Now, he talks about 9 contradictions that happen in global migration. These 9 are these categories, even though they are all dichotomized, they are not necessarily separate. Some of them are overlapping. And we, you know, the 9 number is kind of arbitrary, you can collapse some of them, but I did not want to do injustice to his article. But the point is that the whole process of migration and the result of migration, you can see them as contradictory tendencies. I want to touch upon some of these. Since the 1990s, international migration, as I said, has accelerated. One of the tendencies that you see all over the world, wherever migration happens, is the notion of inclusion and exclusion. Who do people want, or which are the type of people who are invited to come to a country? People who have high levels of skill, high levels of expertise, so that they will become assets to the countries of immigration. Who are the ones who are excluded from this exercise? People who do not have the necessary skills. Now, this is at a global level. We can also see that inclusion and exclusion happens even within the countries of immigration. And that's the experience that a lot of us have as immigrants to different parts of the world. So it is also argued that if you try to exclude immigrants from coming into a particular country, that is not necessarily successful, simply because the immigrant will, the agency that people have, the determination that they have, actually will overcome the policies that you have of excluding them. Europe is a very good example. I was part of an international project where we looked at immigration across European countries and Canada and the US, and we found that no matter what the rules and regulations were, people made it to those countries simply because they wanted to. So the second concept there is the market and the state. In the modernized world, you would say the globalized world, market, the triumph of the market is hailed as an important influence. States are actually becoming really powerless in the competition for markets, in the competition for dominance. In fact, we have seen recent examples of how markets literally override national and international policies. 2008 is a good example in the US. In spite of all the regulations they had, markets literally prevailed. So in this case, what happens is that the states are not capable of controlling the increasing impoverization or increasing marginalization of a large number of people. Because wealth is gone, wealth dictates everything, markets should be unfettered, leave them alone, and the state should have very little control over the economics of the market. The other tension that we have sometimes is what is called the net and the self. It's a notion that that has existed for a long time. There is the tension between an understanding of the rational organization and economic and political institutions and your own self. Do I want to benefit myself or do I want to benefit the entirety, which is the political and economic realm? We are not sure. Because of the polarization that happens, because of the marginalization that happens, many individuals become quite isolated. Their lived experiences are never understood by the setup, by the system, and therefore they look more and more into themselves. The rise of ethnicities in Europe and in any part of the world is a very good example of that kind of looking into yourself and feeling that I need to protect myself, I need to protect our ethnic group, my family, the collective good can stay outside. Again, that's a contradiction that happens. And I want to mention one more before I skip to the next page, which is basically the notion of modernity and post-modernity. The grand narrative, which was part of modernity, talked about a linear progression where societies will progress, the trickle-down effect will make everybody rich one way or the other. Even if you do not become rich, the marginalized will get something out of the big, the rich people. So that was the narrative of modernity. Postmodernity, of course, brought it out to say, well, this does not work that way. There are no grand narratives. There are only meta-narratives. And therefore, no state, nobody can have overall control of these things and let it slide, let it go, let every little piece work to themselves. This is a contradiction that exists. But the inherent danger is that the state then is not in a position to say the collective good must prevail. The state is, in fact, you could argue, and a lot of people already do that, that state is actually withdrawing its presence from the collective self or from the civil society. In fact, many of the notions that come forward in recent days have been examined through that lens. You must all have heard about this notion of social innovation, a very important concept, everybody's talking about it. There are lots of followers of that, but there are also people who feel that this is another mechanism by we are perpetuating the fact that the state can now withdraw, they don't have to do anything for us, that all of us will, in our own little way, create wealth and live in our little corners. So there is that contradiction. I mentioned all of this simply to show that when you reflect upon the fact that immigrants or migrants or newcomers to a country come there and establish themselves, any of these contradictions are really true for them. I always talk about the inclusion and exclusion part. We can see over time, even in Canada, in spite of the best efforts of the government, or people can challenge it to say, well, is it best good enough, have always been looking at how we can integrate people into the mainstream of society. And that's the context in which I even brought out the multiculturalism policy. I want to start by looking at Canadian immigration trends. Again, I will not go into the big details around how did it all come about. In 1967 was the landmark year when Canada abandoned its so-called preferential treatment of certain groups. They instituted a point system where anybody could apply coming to Canada, and it worked for a long time. It is still working, even though at this moment you are not in a position to say where we stand simply because the immigration regulations are changing all the time. In any case, in 2012, the family class was 25.2%, the economic class was 62.4%, and the rest of it I won't be reading. But you can see that this is a clear shift from almost 15 to 20 years ago, and family class was the highest percentage of or family class constituted the highest percentage of newcomers that came. There was a total shift in the last 15 years where the economic class became the predominant class. For those of you who are not necessarily into too much of immigration studies, the economic class is one that where individuals are selected for their potential to contribute economically to Canadian society. The family class is one where an individual joins family that exists already in Canada. So, how are these economic class immigrants selected? Based on their education, their experience, their area of specialization, their ability to speak any one of the official languages, English or French. So these are 9 criteria on which individuals are judged, families are judged, and they are able to come in. In spite of this kind of close scrutiny, what we are finding is that immigrants who come to Canada, there is no evidence to show that the economic class is doing well. In the past, we used to believe that people who come in the family class are not necessarily educated. They do not have the skills to thrive in the labor market, and therefore we should shift our focus to economic class. Even after we have shifted, 10 years afterwards, we don't see any signs of the lessening of the barriers of employment for newcomers. I started UFT in 1994. From then on, I've had the fortune to actually literally study a large group of newcomers as they came into Canada. Every group claims uniqueness. They'll say, we are so different, so we need to be provided with such and such services and so on. Citizenship and Immigration Canada, the Ontario Regional Directorate, was keen on finding out what is it that everybody wants. So I had the opportunity to actually look at a large number of groups as they came in. The Afghan refugees, the Iraqi refugees, the African newcomers, Mandarin-speaking individuals, former Yugoslavian, the list goes on. And everybody claimed uniqueness as in terms of when they come, these are our needs. But much before 2007, when I looked at it, when I looked at almost all the studies, it became very clear that every newcomer that comes to the country wants these things or needs these things. These are the basis for their settlement. And again, those of us who know the immigration literature also talk about settlement needs and integration needs. Settlement is the first phase in which the newcomer actually enters the Canadian society, finds a job, finds a housing, and finds language training if required, and goes on to make connections with people in the community. The connections with people in the community was something of a surprise that happened to me, because everybody kept saying, if you do not know anyone in Canada, you can't find a job. So that social networks became such an important piece. And that's why we all sort of advise people, go and volunteer, you will find new people, you can connect with others. And then sometimes people will come back and say, that was such a waste of my time, all I did was photocopying for that office, and when the job came, they gave it to somebody else. So, in any case, these are the needs that people have when they come in. And the question is then, to what extent does multiculturalism policy or the government actually facilitate the achieving of these things, even though there are settlement agencies, there are people who will advise you on different things, but to what extent are we able to provide these necessities to the people who are coming in for the first time? And we'll do a little bit of conversation about kind of multiculturalism policy. Again, I won't read all of that. It simply states, you know, first of all, the policy came in 1971. It affirmed the value and dignity of all citizens, and stated that everybody who comes to Canada, everybody who is a Canadian, everybody who is a resident of Canada will have all of these rights. This policy was enshrined into a legislation in 1985. Again, it recognizes the diversity of Canadians, which is as a fundamental characteristic of all citizens have got equal status, professes to preserve and enhance their multicultural heritage, and I won't read all of that. But what's interesting to me is the next slide, where we say, Section 3.1 of the Canadian Multiculturalism Act states that it is the policy of the Canadian government to promote the full and equitable participation of individuals and communities of all origins in the continuing evolution and shaping of all aspects of Canadian society and assist them in the elimination of any barrier to that participation. To me, that's the most intriguing part of the multiculturalism policy, and I would argue that we haven't even paid attention to that. I don't even think we have. We would like to claim we did at some point, but definitely, even if you look at the Canadian Heritage as a department, that department is becoming, for lack of a better word, impoverished every year because budget cuts affect them more than anybody else. Because, to me, that demonstrates the importance that's attached to multiculturalism at the federal government level these days. Of course, multiculturalism policy gained a lot of praise for Canada. Internationally, we were known as pioneers in multiculturalism. While the US had a melting pot kind of model of immigrant integration, Canada claimed that every single one of our multicultural groups can maintain their identity. They are not forced to melt into a pot. They can be themselves, all of that. I think a lot has been written about multiculturalism policy, and the critiques of multiculturalism policy are too many. And rightly so. Many people argue that it is the song and dance part of multiculturalism that that was prominent and that received some attention, which is basically because it's non-threatening. Who doesn't want to watch a dance performance? You can do that without challenging any of our values. Without challenging the structural issues that are out there, we can all happily do that. And then we are trying to eliminate them. You know, we talk about the cultural barriers that exist. Those kinds of terminologies do not leave us. Just a little while ago, I got a call from a newspaper guy who wants to write about barriers that newcomers face in the market, in the labor market. And his terminology was cultural barriers. I said, no. We've passed the cultural barrier stage. We need to talk about structural barriers. Those are the things that prevent us from getting into the labor market. If you essentialize culture and make it a characteristic of the individual by which he or she cannot get in the job or market, you know, we are in trouble. So I would also say then that very little attention has been paid to the social justice goals of the policy, especially in relation to equitable participation in Canadian society. And equitable participation means participation in the labor market, participation in civil society, in the political arena, and all of that. And I'm sure every single one of you can identify with the lack of presence that we have as newcomers, or newcomers have in the different aspects of Canadian society, different realms of Canadian society. Now, I want to go to the notion of immigrant integration. It's usually stated that integration is a gradual process by which immigrants to the country become actively participating in the country's economic, civic, and civil and cultural affairs. I also want to sort of acknowledge that a large number of scholars and people who talk about this do not like the word integration. For lack of a better word, we use it quite often to signify the fact that there is an expectation around, or there's a process by which new individuals who come into a country become, or at least they try to become, blend in and become part of this country. At the same time, the expectation is that the institutional setup of the country, the host country, will also make some changes to accommodate the newcomers. So it is actually conceptualized as a two-way process. It should happen from the immigrant side, it should happen from the system side. But most often, if you look at literature, if you look at listen to conversations, it's always seen as the task that has to be accomplished by the immigrant. The immigrant has to blend in. The immigrant has to do this, that, and the other. But very little attention is paid actually to what the system has to do in order to actually make this possible. There are different levels of integration. As I mentioned, you could talk about economic integration, you talk about cultural, civil, political. Without actually positioning all of this into a hierarchy. It is not difficult for us to understand that economic integration comes first. You know, I remember there were some focus groups I was conducting as part of a study. The question was, will you become a candidate for an election if you don't even have a job, if you don't have a house, if you don't have people that you know already? So we don't have to sort of think of this as a linear exercise, a linear process, but definitely the economic integration or the economics of it is actually extremely important. What are the indicators of economic integration? How do we know that somebody is integrated? I mean, any one of us could argue that we are not, because, you know, if the pink slip can come to you at any point in time, with that your integration is out the door. But in many cases, at least having a reasonably good job and income is seen as an indicator. So the employment status is one. Income parity with non-immigrants is another one. Opportunities for career advancement. Credential recognition as well as employment entry into the field of prior employment. These are some of the indicators that we often come across in the literature around indicators of economic integration. The question now is it happening? Even within the broad framework of our multiculturalism policy, which guarantees, or at least encourages, participation, equal participation in all the realms of the society, of Canadian society, how much of this is happening? Are we integrating our immigrants into the country or into our social fabric? Are they able to get in? And my argument is that no, we're not there. Because there is a lot of evidence to show that educational qualifications, work experience, language proficiency are all taken as proxies for literally or even as characteristics of individuals which kind of deny access for them into the labor market. And many of us are familiar with that. So I want to sort of talk about this under a number of headings. One is, how does unemployment and underemployment affect immigrants or newcomers? You know, a lot of people don't like the word immigrants. They always call it newcomers, but at some point you become immigrants. You know, after 10 years, we can still be calling ourselves as newcomers. But in any case, terminology aside, I want to kind of demonstrate, these are all empirical evidence, that underemployment and unemployment is more characteristics of immigrants than non-immigrants. Big earning differentials exist between immigrants and non-immigrants. And then, visible minority immigrants, the new term is racialized immigrants, or racialized communities, have got more of this coming onto them because ethnicity, language, and foreign credentials are used as proxy to create barriers for these individuals to get into the labor market. So racialized visible minority immigrants continue to be marginalized. And then I will share some findings from a study I recently finished. That the fourth point I want to make is gender and economic integration. Does economic integration affect men and women alike? Immigrant men and immigrant women on the same level? Or as visible minority men and visible minority women, where do they stand? So I just want to give some examples. In 2013, the employment rate of landed immigrants to all education, of all education levels was 57.3% compared to 63% of native-born people. Immigrants are often forced to take jobs which are way below their educational qualifications and experience, and to ensure, because they have to ensure the survival of their families. I'm sure every single one of us in this room is familiar with the story of the medical doctor driving a cab in Toronto, the engineer driving another cab in Ottawa, or anywhere else in Canada. This is not a cliche, this is true. I remember, just as an aside, one day, Ryerson's provost president, I had to go somewhere to meet someone. And we were in the taxi, we were in a cab together, we were talking about Ryerson and something. The driver just turned around and said, "You guys are all from Ryerson?" And we said, "Yes." "Oh, my son goes to Ryerson, he's going to be an engineer. I could not practice as an engineer in Canada, but I hope my son would be." He was an engineer with 20 years of experience from the Middle East. This is just one example. I'm sure all of us have got examples. In fact, another time when I was doing a study of foreign trained engineers, which I'll share with you a little while later, I got into a cab in Ottawa. This guy was an engineer from Pakistan. So I said, "Oh, I'm doing a study on engineers," and I was feeling guilty to say anything at all to him to look like I'm taking advantage of his misery. So I said, "I'm doing some work around this, but, you know." He said, "Oh, if you want, I can recruit lots of people for you." And I said, "No, thank you. I'd love to have participants, but this is not necessarily a good way to do it." So what happens is that is very, very, very common. 2 days ago, a doctor qualified in India as a medical doctor, for sure, with some kind of specialization, came to my house and said, "Even if I get to practice as a personal support worker in one of the nursing homes, that I'd be fine." I said, "Look, even for that, you have to study for 2 years. Your medical degree will not help you to get that one because it's a licensed profession here." So the trap into which people feel to fall as they come in is very well known to each of us. There was a time when actually medical doctors from India had to write, to sign an undertaking saying that, "I recognize that when I come to Canada, I may not even practice as a doctor." Even then, people came because of the opportunities that it offers to their children, at least. That's what everybody says. Now, what is the cost of this underutilization of immigrant labor, immigrant potential? Jeffrey Wrights, that some of you know from University of Toronto, a former colleague of mine, he has actually done some work around what is the loss to the Canadian economy in terms of underutilization or non-utilization of immigrant talent. In 1996, it was $4.8 billion. In 2006, it turned out to be $11.37 billion. That is the loss to Canadian economy for underutilizing or not at all utilizing the immigration, sorry, the potentials of immigrants. What are the barriers to education that they all talk about? They say reasons for not securing employment commensurate with the skills are language barriers, requirement of Canadian experience, lack of credential recognition. We are all familiar with that also. I remember reading a certificate that somebody got from the Canadian Association of Social Workers, which said, "Well, your degree is equivalent to our BSW, but that does not mean that you can practice as a social worker in Canada." I said, "What's the use of that certificate? Why are you even saying that?" So it's interesting how contradictory some of these things are. Some of the things have changed, I should acknowledge, but the whole point is that that these three factors are constantly given as reason why they cannot hire foreign or internationally trained professionals. Language barrier is something very interesting because every time, you know, take dentists, take medical doctors, they have to pass the TOEFL exam. And people are telling me that every year the minimum goes up. And I remember doing a focus group with a whole lot of people who came from Egypt some time ago. And then there were some women who were sitting and crying there, saying that, "Look, I passed the TOEFL exam last year, but now that I'm going back to write my other exam, they told me the TOEFL exam scores have gone up. I have to write it again." So it is that game of catch-up that they have to do on a regular basis that makes people wonder, do we really mean what we mean when we tell immigrants from abroad that we really need your skills, right? Now, hiring practices. Again, favorite stories. Who gets hired? People who have networks, people who are referred to one from the other. Even in the study I completed recently, it was demonstrated that when employers referred someone to another employer, they got the job very quickly. Unless you have networks, unless you know people, there's no way that you can break into that labor market. Even if jobs are advertised, by the time you apply, it's already filled. So, now I want to go to earning differentials. I recently completed a study on foreign-trained engineers, or internationally-trained engineers, and compared them with locally-trained engineers to see who gets into the profession of engineering. How can, you know, what are the barriers, how does that happen? Majority of the foreign-trained, so we interviewed 300 foreign-trained engineers and 200 locally-trained engineers. Majority of the foreign-trained participants in the study did not work in the engineering field. So 67% could not get into the engineering field. Even the others who got into the engineering field were only working in the related areas of engineering. They were not professional engineers. None of them had gone through the professional engineering category. So not a single one was what is called a PE, you know, that designation, nobody had. So this is despite professional qualifications and work experience. If you look at their qualifications, 69% had bachelor's degree and the remaining had master's degree in engineering. Majority of them had experiences past their prior experience before they arrived in Canada. And two-thirds of them were actually trained in their countries in one of the official languages of Canada, in English. They did not study engineering in Hindi. They did not study engineering in Arabic. They were English trained. But even then, the criticism is that these foreign trained people do not have English. Now, I don't know what is on this slide. I turned around sometimes. So the second major factor I want to consider is earning differentials. So even if you are lucky to get into the labor market, even if you are able to get into a profession of yours, what are the earning differentials? Immigrants always earn less than non-immigrants for the same work. There's a tremendous amount of literature that's being developed on this one. It's out there. Because of time, I just picked a couple of them. Despite being in the country for a number of years, the gap in employment rates tend not to converge. The immigrant's place of birth is seen as a proxy for her ethnic origin, religion, culture, and all of them are known to have a negative impact on immigrants earning inequalities. Regarding point number two, there was a study which said that in the 1970s and 80s and early 90s, the gap between, it took about 6 or 7 years for a newcomer to catch up with the Canadian mainstream individual working in the same area. The recent figures are that you need at least 13 to 14 years. Sometimes it may not even be there. You may not even reach the earning sort of equivalency as a Canadian. What happens to visible minority immigrants? The slide is the same. Oh, okay. The visible minority immigrants, that's my third group or third factor I want to bring in. Even if you, so everybody comes into the country, there are of course people from different parts of the world. What happens to racialized communities? Visible minority immigrants are in particular face securing employment on account of cultural markers as ethnicity, language, and foreign credentials. In fact, I have an interesting quick story to tell. There's a woman who some time ago met me and said she doesn't know how to crack into, he's at social work or health admin or something, I can't remember. Public health, yes. So she was told, she's originally from the Caribbean, so she was told to send her degree, so evaluation and all of that, and people, you know, she frantically sent it everywhere. She got the assessment. She was told that she has to go and do her degree again because degrees from the Caribbean are not accepted here. She said, did you read my transcript? They said, I think so. She had a degree from Stanford. Just because they looked at the place of birth, they said, oh, you have to go and do your degree again. So sometimes some of these things become so evident for us that it is not what you have in your degree that matters, but sometimes the proxy is your ethnicity, Racialized visible minority immigrants continue to face the economic penalty even in a second generation. Again, this is, the paper is out yesterday, so I shouldn't say it's forthcoming. But the point is that in the study that I talked about, the 300 internationally trained and 200 locally trained, it was seen that visible minorities or racialized individuals had difficulty getting jobs, even if they were locally trained. That was shocking to me. I had always thought that once we have the Canadian education, as they all talk about, it should not be a problem. Everyone should get the same job. No. South Asians, Latin Americans, and Caribbeans were the ones who did not find it easy to get into the engineering profession, even with a local degree or a domestic degree. That was shocking. Simply because, again, you're attributing, you know, all other kinds of elements to your identity at that point. So I think this is the study you're talking about. I had another slide and I forgot to move it around. Location of the study, location of engineering training was important. It is seen as a marker of ethnicity, as I said, you know, if you saw the Caribbean, so go and repeat your degree again. Apart from being discriminated against the labor market, Canadian experience may be internationally trained professionals, discrimination on dimensions of the identity such as race, ethnicity, and gender. Actually, we wrote a paper saying the intersections of race, gender, and class for foreign-trained individuals. Visible minority groups such as South Asians and locally trained engineers had lower odds of securing an engineering job compared to whites. These are all sort of qualitative and quantitative analysis that have got significance, and therefore, you know, there's no reason to believe that this is just perception. It was there. But what was interesting was that in this study, I also administered what is called a workplace attitudinal survey. In other words, if people felt that they were discriminated against or not, there was a survey, there's a scale that I, you know, from 1 to 5, do you feel that we're discriminated against you? Do you feel that, you know, people kind of consider you different and so on and so forth? The locally trained engineers did not say that they felt that way, even though they are in the same boat as the immigrants. Simply because of their upbringing, they live in Canadian society, they did not think of as a separate, you know, group that came in. They are Canadians for all practical purposes. They have been here, they went to school with all their friends. So why would I feel that I am discriminated? But they were. On the other hand, the foreign trained engineers who did the survey did not want to talk about discrimination. So to a question, do you feel like you have been discriminated against? The answer is, I don't think so. In fact, I had to do a little bit of a modification of my title. When I administered the survey, I took out the discrimination, experiences of foreign-trained engineers in the workplace. Because foreign-trained engineers did not want to attribute racism for their lack of, you know, or for the inability to get in the labor market simply because they would feel that, oh, what if this comes out and if somebody gives me away and I don't want to think. And they kind of internalized it, thinking that, oh, I am not qualified enough, I do not have the capacity, and maybe that's why I can't get a job. It is not the system, because they are not literally thinking in terms of the systemic issues. I will quickly go through my last part. One slide is gender and economic integration. Recent immigrant women have been found to have more likely gone in part-time work, in casual work, and look at their income. Median income is $11,300, less than that of Canadian born. Visible minority immigrant women are likely to be poorer than other immigrant women. Again, things that we, not that we don't know, but that exist, that has been proved. I feel guilty that I have not really touched on now what do we do, go from here. I'm thinking maybe it can be a collective exercise of where do we go from here. Even though the federal government has put together some, you know, Canadian immigrant integration program in the countries of origin, there is a foreign credential recognition program in Canada. The province has actually put together some agencies to assess foreign credentials, all of that. But the only program that, in my opinion, works is the bridging programs that the province funds. Again, it is a fight to get money for those programs. Ryerson has bridging program for nutrition, midwifery, social work, and engineering. Most of the people who go through that program get jobs because the placement actually takes them to a real Canadian workplace. They get to meet people, they network with people. So almost 98% success in terms of employment. But again, it's a struggle to get the money simply because the province is saying now we can't afford that. We have to be self-sustainable. So that's that. Over and over again, we have heard that internships, mentorship programs, these kinds of bridging programs, networking events actually create opportunities for people to enter their field of practice. So we need to increase those more. And we also need to actually look at structural barriers. The professional associations are seen as gatekeepers. Not only seen as, they are the gatekeepers. How do we break that? How do we even make sure that they do not, you know, change the requirements every week? In fact, 2 days ago, I was to help out this person who had this medical degree. I was looking through websites to tell him, this is what you do when you come to Ontario. It took me half an hour to come with 3 pages of, you know, useful material to tell this person these are the steps you go through. So even after years and years of going through this, the real information is not there in an accessible format for many people. So appropriate information for job seekers, which is missing. Even with the program they have in those countries, I had a recently organized a conference where we talked to people who are established in Canada and asked them what helped you and what happened. I won't go into that now. But almost all of them said that, you know, integration program in India was of no use because the information they gave us was totally out of date. So, and finally, what we need to do is to have structural changes that creates diversity and inclusion as not only values, but also practices that we implement. You know, having a statement in the mission statement as, oh, we value diversity and we celebrate, you know, diversity, not good enough. Where are the barriers? Where do we live, you know, sort of prevent, or how do we prevent people from coming into these jobs? How do we, you know, examine those, and we have to change those. We have been saying this forever. I absolutely have no idea whether we have successfully transformed any social institution to accept more, to have more immigrant-friendly atmosphere so that they can apply and get jobs on the sheer merit of their applications. I'll stop here. I'm sure the collective wisdom could come forward to find more solutions to this problem. Thank you.
Thank you very much. We have about 15 minutes for your questions.
I have a question basically about the typical engineer who's driving a taxi. We've heard that story for a long, long time, for years and years, and the government always said, oh yes, we're going to change that situation. So what has the government actually done to take steps to change that? Has there been any effective results, action?
The bridging programs have probably, the bridging programs here and there have been very useful. The other is what's called the Fairness Commissioner in Ontario. I don't know whether you know that that setup. I think people can, it's Jean Augustine. Jean Augustine, she used to be an MP before. She has an office, she has people around her. Don't ask me what they have done. I have no idea. They say that this is actually to remove barriers for professional accreditation of newcomers. But I don't have any statistics as to how many people went to that. Went through all of that and what kind of changes were made. Because this study is not too old. The one I did is 2008 to 14. Like, I finished it last paper. So
There's an organization called CAPE, which is Council of Something Professional Engineers from Abroad. That started with a membership of like 5 people. Now it has got 5,000 members in Ontario. And these are not professional engineers. These are all immigrants who came in, have engineering degrees, but are not able to get into becoming. And the person who chairs that is a woman who is a civil engineer, has a PhD in civil engineering. She's one of the very few female members of that group in England right before she immigrated.
Could you say a little more about the Virgin program? What is it
look like? I can clearly talk about the social work one. They advertise, and people know that already, but they advertise, and they do some interviews of individuals and bring them. They take a class of 20 to 25 every year, and then they take them, they offer a number of courses to these individuals. I mean, they all know the fundamentals of social work. It's about social policy in Canada, maybe some other things like that, maybe the workplace in Canada, a few courses like that. And then they also have to do a project, they also have a placement. So it's about, if I'm not mistaken, 14, 15 months. And through the placement, most people find jobs. And you know, to be fair, sometimes some of the internationally trained social workers are not able to write papers as we would want them to be, so then they support them to do that. But most of them get jobs. Yeah. But again, I have no guarantees around the continuity of this program, because the province is continuously saying you have to be self-sustained, you can't give this money.
Just a little comment on that. Actually, the province has increased the funding to those programs and has negotiated an agreement with the federal government for direct transfer of funds to support the programs. And so the issue is that there are many universities, colleges, and employment-serving agencies that want to offer the programs. There are over 100 active currently in the province. And the programs have to be competitive in terms of their costs and value for money.
Is that a new one that they increased the funding?
No. It was announced last year in the budget for provincial increase. However, the agreement with the federal government is just a renewal of an agreement that existed previously for 3 years.
Thank you for that. Okay.
Do you think that...
Sorry, do you mind if I take this question?
No, not at all. I haven't seen.
Okay.
Okay. Yeah.
Well, you cited in that the loss, economic loss, of due to underutilizing the credentials of experience of migrants, or...
newcomers. Yes. $11.8 billion.
So, what do you think is the reason
for
why the loss
is
seems to be bearable?
To tell you the truth, if we were serious enough, we should be actually evaluating our immigration policy and its implementation. The success of a policy is measured in terms of certain indicators. We don't have any indicators for immigrant integration as at the federal level. We don't really look at who is coming. We know who is coming. What are they doing? What do they end up doing? What's their income? None of those things. So once they come, they get lost in this whole, sort of sea of people. And it is researchers. It's actually based on 2006 census and some economic tax data that came in. So, the reason is, the government would say that's why we educated immigrants, that they will use their capabilities to find jobs and all. Yeah, I don't think it's, apart from academics, I don't even think anybody's talking about that.
Mine's along a little bit the evaluation as well. With the funding programs, the bridging programs, etc., I'm wondering if we're tracking, and it's a question at the same time, if we're tracking enough the transformation or the outcomes on individuals and whether or not it's impacting on structural or systemic changes within organizations.
The effectiveness of the bridging programs are being tracked. Because when you report to the ministry, you need to tell them how many people got jobs, how many people enrolled, all of those kinds of things. So at least there is some tracking there.
And the tracking is on the individual. I'm wondering if the tracking is also on the any systemic changes or transformation changes that may occur within the institutions.
No.
Okay.
Yes, if it's a funded institutional change project,
yes,
it is tracked.
Yeah.
My question was about the engineering study you did. Was it Ontario based?
Yeah.
So is there, do you have any insight into whether it's a question of a lot of engineers coming to Ontario and not getting jobs, when there are jobs available in Alberta or Manitoba? Is there some kind of a,
there's a, I can't call it a trend, but there's a tendency there. A whole lot of people, for example, in the 2011 census, 11? Yeah, we have 14. 11 census, it was very clear that Ontario is losing very qualified immigrants. They were, so we lost our space as the first immigrant destination. We were there for a long, long time. Why? A lot of people were coming and straight away going to Alberta and places like that, Saskatchewan, where they have jobs. So partially that, but not necessarily so. But there's another market force here. The Canadian schools of engineering were producing a large number of engineers as well. So this engineering thing is a little blip, I would argue, but the doctors also are in the same boat, simply because there was, for a short period of time, immigration policy in Canada was based on what is called the human resource model rather than the national occupation list model. The human resource model simply said, bring in educated people. Let it be PhDs or engineers. They'll find their way in the labor market because they have the ability to do that. They have the skills to do that. So that was partly that. Now I think they've gone back to the national occupational list, and maybe there could be some changes. Yeah.
I'm just wondering, what are the incentives for employers to hire, so for example, I work at the University of Toronto in Scarborough, and we have a need, unfortunately, for mental health support for our youth.
Mm-hmm.
And in our area, so for example in Durham, there is no qualified psychiatrist that students can go to quickly at the high school level.
Right.
The university level, we have a doctor of office with a full trained staff.
Right.
The wait is very long.
Uh-huh.
So I'm just wondering, if we wanted to, for example, we have this need, how can we, incent the talent to go where the need is as a community? What can we do, and are there any incentive programs that we should be aware of?
Not on a program basis. There was a talk at some point of rewarding employers for actually employing volunteering professionals at some point. I don't know whether that's gone, whether it has gone anywhere at all. But if you're looking for an immediate fix to your problem, your MP is the best person. You simply go and tell this person, look, we absolutely need some people, what can you do? And sometimes they can come up with creative solutions. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Dr. George. We have a small presentation to Dr. George, and we also have an honor of being with us today, the Consul General of Philippines, Ms. Jennifer Macalun West, who will present this small token of appreciation.
Thank you very much. And for me personally, it was so fascinating listening to your presentation, Dr. George, because I encounter on a day-to-day basis the micro of what you're talking about. But having a macro and academically rigorous assessment of the issue is really very enlightening to me. Thank you very much. I would like to add my personal thanks. And
we have here a small yes, it's quite, it's beautiful.